Hey friends, welcome to the WFTDA.tv on Twitch. I am your host, Derelia, and you're watching Collab Lab, a show dedicated to highlighting creators from the Derby community in a collaborative platform. Today, I'm excited to talk to Samara Barks, also known as Sam I Slam. Sam is a former skater and coach from Houston Roller Derby. Art is an important part of her everyday life, and she's been a professional artist since 2002, working as a technical 3D designer, illustrator, and traditional fine artist who also mentors and teaches middle-aged school children in the Austin area. Please bring us a warm welcome to Samara Barks, also known as Sam. Hi, Sam. Thank you for joining us today.
Hello. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. Enjoying this cool Michigan weather. How about yourself?
Well, it's hot like Hades down here in Austin, Texas. It's about 100 degrees, but I'm doing good.
Well, I hope your air conditioning is working if you have. I can't imagine what it's like living in the hot, humid weather down in Texas. So I hope you're staying cool during this time.
Oh yeah. I'm used to it now. I've been living down south for the past 12 years. As used to it as you can get through the sweat and mosquitoes.
So Sam, why don't you introduce yourself to the folks here in the chat? Just why don't you tell us your about your Derby days, your origin story? You know, how you came to be with Houston Roller Derby.
Moved to Houston at the end of 2010 from Pittsburgh, where I went to school, originally from Detroit. Once I got to Houston, I met up with some cool people. I was in a smart car group, and one of the ladies in the smart car group played rec league for Houston Roller Derby. She invited me to come see the practice, and I saw one practice, and I knew I wanted to do it. So I signed up for rec league in 2011. With the Machete Bettys for Houston Roller Derby, and it was pretty much on from there. I love the sport, and I was hooked like immediately. It took me a couple tries to get on the home team, because when I found Houston Roller Derby, I did not know how to skate. So my cool coach, Scar Wars, was one of my first rec league coaches, and she trained me up and motivated me and encouraged all us freshies to keep practicing. And it took me like two tries, and then I made it on a new home team for Houston Roller Derby. And I got to help start the fourth new team for Houston Roller Derby, the Valkyries. We were a bunch of fresh meat and five veterans. So it was like the Bad News Bears was our first season. We lost everything except for one exhibition game.
I feel like that's a pretty common flow for newer teams. You know, you got to kind of work your way to getting those W's.
Oh, we definitely did. We sucked so hard that first year, but it was a learning year. And the awesome five vets that left their home teams to come join the new team and make the new team with all fresh meat. It was just like, I'm so sorry you guys have to do this with us. Thank you. We definitely earned our wins once we started getting W's.
Now, I know how you told us how you found roller derby, being a part of a smart car group and having a friend who was doing it. But why don't you tell us a little bit about your sports background? You know, based on what I know of you so far, it sounds as though roller derby was really the perfect sport for you based on what you've done in your past.
Oh, yeah. I used to play high school basketball. And when I got to college, I went to art school. It wasn't like I went to a big league college or anything. We played intramural basketball and football. We played against the culinary kids. We played against people that lived in the neighborhood. I went to school in Pittsburgh, the Art Institute of Pittsburgh. So I played basketball and full contact football with guys with no gear. I've always been kind of, I've always played sports and I like contact sports. So when I saw roller derby and I was like, yeah, I'm doing that. I don't know how, because I didn't know how to skate, but I was like, I don't care. I'm doing it.
Well, I'm glad the learning to skate part didn't hold you back, because when you played roller derby, did you mostly jam or were you a blocker as well? I saw most of your pictures. You're donning the star.
That was crazy because I was mostly a blocker, but I grew to love jamming. I did both. I just wanted to knock people over and get them out of my way. I grew into jamming like towards the end of my home team skating, but yeah, it was like I was a bigger skater, so I love the fact that I could make my own holes while my team worked on defense. If I needed offense, I would call for it, but for the most part, I just liked being able to take the star, and I wasn't fast, but I was strong, so yeah, I did both. So I wasn't scared of the star.
You slam your way through the pack with ease.
Yes.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about your name, Sam I Slam? Where did that come from? And is there any story behind your derby number?
There is. Actually, when I was in rec league, we had a board for all the fresh meat new skaters. And I was like, I don't know what name to pick. So I went through the list of names that they had in there. And I was like, oh, Sam I Slam. I loved Dr. Seuss, so I was like, it's easy, it's my name. I like Dr. Seuss, so like my helmet and all my stuff, T1, T2 is thing one, thing two. Before they changed the regulations for numbers, you could have, of course, letters and numbers. So I was Sam I Slam, thing one, thing two. But a lot of people said it looked like tits. When T1, T2 was together, it looked like it spelled tits. Well, that's the story behind my name and my number. It's Dr. Seuss themed.
Now, you say you like Dr. Seuss, and I know that you had mentioned earlier that you teach and mentor children in the Austin area. What is it that you're doing right now?
When I first moved to Austin, I was teaching in after-school programs and summer programs. I was teaching them 3D design. Teaching them how to use 3D printers, rapid 3D prototyping, basically teaching them what they could do by learning 3D and the different career paths they could take with using 3D in STEM. And the other thing that I teach currently, I'm a part of the Chula League's Little Artist, Big Artist program. So they team up middle school children with professional artists for 10 weeks, and we basically teach them whatever they feel like learning from our professional lives, how to be working artists, whatever that may be. Since I do so many different things, I get the chance to teach you maybe woodworking or illustration, traditional illustration, digital illustration. So basically they get teamed up with a professional artist to see how we do what we do. And I've done that for 2 years. This year we were going to do it again, but the program got put on hold, of course, because of COVID. Those are the two different ways that I've taught after school programs, just traditional art with kids for years.
So we know what the children are getting from this being paired with a professional artist like yourself. What would you say is your biggest takeaway from developing this relationship with the children?
Getting to see what the next generation is going to do. It's really, I have been real lucky to get paired with two young ladies that already were into art, and they were into similar things that I was into. So it was really lucky I got paired with them. Getting to see them explore the different options that they have and just letting them create, just letting them see what they want to do with no pressure. It's not like I'm saying, oh, you need to go into this line of work. It's not that oriented. It's basically seeing what the kids are interested in and kind of fostering, helping to foster that foundation for them and hoping maybe one day they'll go into a creative career or STEM career, whatever they choose to. But just the opportunity to see, kind of see what I would have wanted as a kid. Those kind of programs I would have eaten up as a kid. So the idea that these programs in East Austin, which is predominantly Black and Brown community, giving those kids in East Austin the opportunity that the kids in the suburbs already had. I teach in after-school programs where kids have accessibility to a library full of 3D printers, and they have art programs, and they have after-school 3D workshops, but a lot of the kids in East Austin don't get exposed to those kind of opportunities. So that's the other part of why I like to do that.
It sounds like a very rewarding experience on both ends, and being able to give to those young folks what you hoped you had had when you were their age. I think that speaks volumes in your commitment to helping to develop the youth to stay on track and to keep staying dedicated to their passions and follow their dreams. Because sometimes I find that when you're really focused on something during those adolescents, you know, trying to find somebody who's going to encourage you through that while you're trying to grow up and learn what it is to become an adult or a teenager can really be hard to find. So I think that's just amazing that you take the time to do that. And, you know, I think if there's folks out there who can offer some part of themselves to the youth and help cultivate what's coming, we should definitely try to do that more often.
Yeah, and this is in my neighborhood. I live in East Austin. I'm not from Austin, but I've lived here for the past 4 years, I think. And I'm from Detroit. I know the disparaging areas that kids live in, and it's also allowing Black and Brown children to see that, yes, you can achieve those things as well. It's going to be a little bit harder, but you get to work with professionals that are doing some of the things that you're interested in. So you get to see, yes, we can do those things.
Now, you shared a couple of really lovely derby pieces with us for this episode. So why don't you tell us a little bit about each one as they come up on the screen? Are these the types of images that you would be getting while working with these children in Austin?
This is a part of my skater zodiac that I did in 2017. For the kids, it's literally what they want to do. So when we interact with them in the Little Artist, Big Artist program, we basically show them all the things that we can do, and they pick whatever sector of that they want to do. So that's a watercolor painting. So I can show the kids, hey, I can teach you watercolor painting. I can teach you digital painting. I can teach you laser cutting. And the student just basically says, oh, okay, I'm interested in this track. Let's go do something like this. My last little artist did a, what did she do? She did a 3D laser cut piece. My first little artist did a digital Godzilla poster for her brother because he loved Godzilla. So she learned how to use digital art to create a poster and sticker set. And the other little artist I had, I took her to the laser studio and she learned how to do that. She learned a couple of different things, but that was her final art piece. So these skater zodiacs are just something I wanted to do. I thought it would be fun to interpret the zodiac. It's been interpreted many millions of different ways, but I just put a spin on it for skaters because I'm a skater. A lot of my art is my mixed passions of skating or true crime. So you'll see that theme pop up a lot in my art. This one.
Tell
right
me about
here
this
was,
piece.
That's Merm Skates. That's Millie, one of the Moxie girls. I just love her skate style. Marshall FX Mixer, he took this awesome photo of her stalling on a in a bowl, and I was like, it was Inktober, I think, in 2017, and the word of the day was graceful. So Inktober, you get a different word every day, and you interpret whatever that is for you. So when I saw that picture, I was like, that's graceful. So I did a watercolor and ink painting of her doing that. And I got to show her that in RollerCon last year. I finally got to meet her and gave her a signed copy of that.
Oh, that is so awesome.
Yeah, she's really cool. She's really cool about it.
I had a friend when I was younger who was working on a painting of me, and I think she's still working on it. She messages me every now and then with updates because she's like, I have to keep repainting it because you keep getting older. So now I have to start over. But how awesome that would be just to be gifted something so beautiful like this. And it really does capture grace and beauty. I mean, and she's doing her thing. I mean, look how calm and happy.
Yeah, she was literally just zen, just doing a toe stop stall on the edge of the coping. And I was like, I'm not there yet. I love the way she skates.
Now, I understand some of your artwork has actually been featured before with Bout Betty's. And I know we have a picture here from the promo. And I had an important question. So why don't you explain the inspiration behind this, and then I'll hit you with my question.
Okay. Well, Bout Betty's, they do a different box every month. And they reached out to me and said, hey, do you want to collab on a box? I was like, of course. Taco and Ratchet are like the coolest people. So my theme for that month was Doctor Who. And at that time, the new Doctor was coming out and she's a woman for that season. So I was like, oh yeah, I'm like all in for that. So they just let me design whatever I wanted. And this design went on a tank top. And I also did a separate sticker design. And those went into that box for that month. And it was really cool.
So I have to know, are you a Doctor Who fan? I'm assuming. Who is your favorite Doctor?
Oh, that's a hard one. It's between David Tennant and Mark Smith. Like, every time a new Doctor came up, I was like, I will never like this Doctor. And then I would watch the season and I'd be like, I like this Doctor. Those two are my favorites.
Yeah, Matt Smith and really David Tennant. Yeah.
I was mad when Matt Smith left.
Yeah, he used to play soccer. I don't remember the whole backstory behind it, but yeah, I feel like he auditioned while he was playing soccer, and there's an episode where he actually it's the one with James Corden where he's the apprentice and they're out there playing soccer on the field. And I was like, oh, dang. So he really does have skills playing soccer.
Nice.
So just a little Doctor Who fact there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm right there with you. It's really hard to pick between those two. And then having them back to back is, it's fun to rewatch that time frame over and over again.
And I didn't start watching Doctor Who until the Doctor before Tennant was, what's his name? It starts with an E and I can't remember his name. I actually liked his Doctor. That's when I started watching Doctor Who.
Yeah, I came in the Tennant phase when I started dating my husband. He was like, you've never seen Doctor Who? This is something that you have to get into. And then I never looked back.
I mean, I knew of it, but the original Doctor Who's didn't grab me like that. They just didn't.
Yeah.
And going back to watch the older Doctor Who's, it's like, I'll still watch them, but I like the newer ones.
We came in at the right time for us.
Mm-hmm. That.
So the style of this piece is really beautiful, and it does remind me a little bit of kind of painting. Did you create this all in digital media, or was there any actual like physical drawing that you did as well?
All my work starts in my sketchbooks. It's very rare that I just go straight to a tablet and draw. Everything starts in my sketchbooks. So I don't know. I can draw digitally, but I don't know, for me, I like to draw in my sketchbook. I like to have that tangible thing to go back to. And I usually, watercolor and inks are my traditional media that I like to use the most. But that definitely did start in my sketchbook. And I usually scan them in and then I go and start doing the digital work on top of my sketches.
Well, you've done some really amazing pieces, and a couple that we're going to talk about today are very large. So the next part is, I want to talk about the Mabel Davis Skate Park mural. I believe mm-hmm. it's called How Heavy Is Your Heart? You've provided us with a beautiful video of you doing that. And I would just love to ask you some questions about the artistic process while we watch this video, because there's so many things mm-hmm. as somebody who doesn't do art on the regular basis, that I just have questions on. Mm-hmm. And even my husband was looking at it with me. We're trying to figure out like the thought process behind some of the things here. So if you would like to, to take us through this, I'll just pop in every now and then with some questions. And, this is just amazing work.
Well, I got the project through Art in Public Places and the Tempo 2D programs here in Austin. They put a call out for artists to do sites around the city, and you had to put in a bid for it. Basically, you had to do some preliminary sketches to kind of say, hey, this is what I'm thinking. You had to do, we had to also do community outreach. So you had to contact the people in the community that use that site. It's a skate park on the left-hand side, and it's also a public pool. So what I had to do was ask input from the skate community, the people that use that park the most, the people that use a swimming pool, and kind of show them my work and kind of gauge what they would like to see on that wall. There was an artist previous to me. You get a year for your artwork to be up, and then after that, you buff it out, and it gets passed on to the next artist. So I won the bid for this site. It was a 40-foot by 7-foot wall. That's the first time I've ever done anything that large. And it was like exciting and terrifying at the same time. So I had met the two people in the video with me are Laced and Found, Ricky and Jay from Laced and Found. They're local artists in Round Rock, Texas, which is basically the Austin area. And I met them at another art event and saw him do, he does graffiti, beautiful graffiti artist. So I reached out to him because I said, I've never sprayed before. I was going to hand paint all this. And he was like, girl, no, don't do that. I was going to hand paint that and that would have taken me forever. So I was like, I don't want to be out this summer hand painting this big ass mural by myself. So he was like, I got you. The city grant, you know, covered me paying them to come bring them on so I could learn from him. I didn't want them to just come out and paint this for me or just want, you know, do all the outlines and I paint it. I know he actually taught me like his technique, how he does something so large to keep the proportions of my original piece. So we got out there and he was like, this is how you do it. Let's get to it.
So I noticed on, at the beginning of this video, I was like, wait a second, there's words. And so I started reading it and it's the alphabet. And then it says, next time, won't you sing with me? What? Tell me about that.
So that was one of the techniques that he taught me, how to take my, you know, small scale drawing and blow it up to 40 feet by 7 feet. So what he does is a grid system. It's somewhat like a traditional artist grid system where you measure out blocks. But instead of measuring out all these blocks and taking all that time, what we do is we just spray paint a grid, any kind of grid. It could be symbols, it can be letters, it can be whatever you want it to be. And then from there, he takes a picture of it and we superimpose it over my drawing. So we look at my drawing with that grid, that those glyphs superimposed over my drawing. And now I know where all the lines on my drawing fall. So we just outline the whole piece. And now we have an outline for how to paint the whole piece without having to use a projector. Because sometimes when I first started, I used projector. Now that gives you the opportunity to not have to have that projector and electricity. If you don't have access to electricity, use a projector for an outdoor mural, which you might not have. That's just a different technique to get that big piece up on the wall.
What What types of paint, or do you have a favorite brand of paint that you use when you're doing, you know, murals like this that you need to be long lasting outdoors?
Right now I use Montana Gold. Just the different type of the different spray paints, Montana. Other than that, it's just exterior paint that can last the weather, the heat, the sun, the rain, the spray paint and outdoor paint, simple outdoor paint with primer already in it.
Now, is that something you can just get at your local hardware store?
Mm-hmm. Bear. I use Bear, like the higher end Bear. You can use the $30 a gallon, but you don't really, it depends on where your mural's going to be. But yeah, I use Bear, like the second from the top brand in Montana spray paint. But that's all it was.
What types of brushes were you using when you were doing the hand painting for the finer details?
Foam brushes and regular synthetic brushes you can get, just cheap synthetic brushes, nothing. You don't have to spend hundreds of dollars on brushes that are going to get destroyed with exterior paint. But a lot of foam brushes, let me see if I have one right here, like foam brushes like this. So you don't, so you don't get the bristle marks in your work. Yep, foam brushes, lots and lots of foam brushes. And you can wash them and reuse them. And they have the hard edges.
How long did it take you folks to finish this whole process, start to finish?
A few days, actually. Yeah, we just did it in, 3 days total. And then I just went back a couple of days after that to do some really like nitpicky fine details on it. But we knocked out the majority of it in 2 days.
Now, I'm assuming this is something that you have to maintain during the time you have the space. Do you keep those paints on hand, or is it something where you have a color number palette and you take that there and say, hey, I need to get a little bit more of this and a little bit more of that?
No, I definitely kept those paints. So in the bid, you have to kind of tell the city how much you have to have an allotment for the project itself, and you have to have an allotment for upkeep. So you kind of, you know, overbuy because you have to maintain that for a year. So I definitely kept the extra paint, and actually had last week I had to go and touch it up because somebody tagged it. It wasn't a bad tag. It took like 10 minutes for me to fix it, but somebody tagged it. So I definitely have to do the maintenance on it throughout the year that it's up.
Well, I'm glad that you are prepared to keep it looking beautiful. I have a couple questions in the chat. One of them is from Chloroform Cupcake, and she wanted to know, what are your art influences?
Oh, wow. A lot of people say my work is like a mix of graffiti and like anime and comics. It kind of is. But one of my main art influences was Ernie Barnes. I don't know if you're familiar with Ernie Barnes. He used to play football, actually, but he's an African-American artist who I grew up looking at his work, and he did a lot of exaggerated bodies and difficult perspectives, and his work was centered around showing the everyday life of Black people, just us living, because that was not normalized. So he just showed us the beauty of Black people, the beauty of Black culture, the beauty of us, and the way he drew his bodies and his compositions heavily influenced my artwork. If you ever watch Good Times, that piece in Good Times, Juke Joint, that's Ernie Barnes' work. That's like one of the pieces that everybody can recognize as Ernie Barnes' work. But that work, my mother's work, my mother was an artist, looking at her work growing up. So those two heavy influences for my art and how it looks and has evolved over the years, I guess.
Do you have a favorite type of art that you like to create? I know you say most everything starts in your sketchbook, but if you could pick, you know, your favorite style of art to just chill out and just zone out on, what would you say works best for you?
Inks. A lot of people don't know, though, might not like it, but a lot of my ink work is kind of macabre. I'm a huge horror fan, so a lot of my ink work is kind of on a dark side. But I don't know, I guess that's the beauty of just working in dark India ink. That style of my art is probably my favorite. So, you know, I have my happy, bright, you know, skate art, and then I have my horror art, and then I have like comic book illustrative kind of sci-fi art that I do.
Do you find your mood will influence which direction you're going to go that day?
Definitely. Yeah, definitely. Depends on what's going on in my headspace as to what kind of art I'm going to do. Or like any artist, like our environments and what's going on in society always heavily influence us, and we reflect that. We hope, even if subconsciously, we reflect that.
If you could give a recommendation for types of India ink or brand, like names that you use, what would you recommend to somebody who's looking to try to get into that type of medium, if I could get my words out proper?
The two brands that I use are Higgins. That's one brand. My go-to is Speedball Super Black India Ink. It's super, super, super deep, dark black. And I know because I spilled it in my carpet and it won't come out. One of these tipped over like a year or so ago. And I was just like, my carpet's beige. Why? But those are the two brands that I use. And I also do a lot of gold in my work. And I use Steve Roberson. They have beautiful true metallic paints. It's from the UK, and it looks like liquid, like this name is liquid gold. It's one of my favorite accents in my ink work. So those three things are like in heavy rotation when I do black and white ink work.
Now, when you're out traveling, not now, obviously, but when you're hitting up the cons, Are those the supplies that you take with you when you're working the booth doing commissions, let's say at RollerCon?
Yep, I do. Outside of that, I just take, I usually take this with me, and it just has all my pens and markers that I use. Like that goes everywhere with me.
It's like every artist must have. You've got to have something on the go, so when the moment hits you, you're ready.
Yep. The amount of sketchbooks and notebooks, I have a problem. I have a real problem. I have so many notebooks and travel sketchbooks. And if my friends know me, they're like, I could just get her a sketchbook or a gift certificate to the art store. She's going to buy more sketchbooks. But yeah, this little roll goes everywhere with me.
That's an awesome setup. It looks a lot more practical than taking like the traditional plastic clippy, you know, pencil box.
Yeah, I mean, it fits in my bag. So it's just one of my art mentors was like, you need to get one. And I was like, you're correct, because I've just been carrying loose markers and pens and inks in my bag.
Yeah, Cake says that's a sweet looking utility belt.
I know. I need to make one that like fits on my hips and be like, ha, got it.
Just pull it out.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about RollerCon, because I know that you are involved with RollerCon in a couple different ways. Am I understanding correctly that you designed the logos for Bitch Please versus Side Eye?
I did. It was a very tongue-in-cheek happening.
So for those who don't know, Bitch Please versus Side Eye is the first bout composed entirely of black skaters from the Black Scarby Doll is the reigning queen of side eye, who captains against Hammer for Bitch Please. They feature skaters from Gotham Girls Roller Derby, Atomic Roller Girls, Texas Roller Girls, Angel City Derby Girls, LA Derby Dolls, and Women's Bank Track Roller Derby, Atlanta Roller Girls, and Rat City, just to name a few. So why don't you tell me a little bit about that experience and what it brings to the derby community?
The Black Roller Derby Network is awesome. It's it was a much needed thing, and I'm glad for Scarby and Hammer and everybody who's in charge of it for starting the group. That ultimately was also another support group that urged me to go ahead and get Mixed Hues going. What it means to the derby community, when I started skating and going to tournaments and just going to games in general and looking at the merch in the skate community as a whole, roller derby, everything, knowing the history of skating in the Black community, we were not being represented at all in any of the merch, any of the artwork. I didn't see it anywhere on the main stage, and definitely not skaters being shown in advertisements for tournaments. And it bothered me, because we put the same amount of time and energy and love and money into the sport. So I started to make things just for myself, and I would share them in Blabby Network. And people were like, well, where did you get that? Like, well, I made it. So people started to really encourage me, like, we want this out there. We want to see this out there. So I started to think about seriously organizing myself and putting out what I wanted to see out in our community. Side Eye at Bitch Please is started as a joke in the group, and they were like, what if we had, you know, a game, a team that was just us, for us, by us? And somebody posted the pictures in the group, and they were like, is anybody in here? Can anybody in here clean these up? And I was like, I'll take a stab at it, sure. And that's how Side Eye and Bitch Please kind of, those images kind of came about. And Scarby graciously volunteered her visage for one of the team logos, and they just came out really cool. Somebody else was just like, hey, this funny ass picture of Prince really looks like it needs to be a part of this. I don't even remember who suggested it. I was like, I'll turn it into an image. So that's how those images were born. And the awesome people in Black Roller Derby Network, all the support and all the money and all the kind words and just dedication to bringing that all together. It was awesome being a part of that when it started. And I actually got to skate in the first game.
That was going to be my next question. So which team were you on, and what was your primary role?
Side Eye. I was a blocker, and I jammed somewhat, but I still kind of sucked. So that game was way above my pay grade. It was so much like A-level skaters on that team. I don't even know what I was doing out there, but I still enjoyed myself.
You were taking in the entire experience and putting it in your toolbox, so that way, right? Just absorb the moment.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I think this is something that people really need to be aware of, and make sure that, you know, I can't imagine what it's like to be a person of color. I have no relation to that at all. And I think that we need to continue in the derby community to showcase, you know, moments like this and communities and groups like this within the roller derby community. Because there are little subcultures inside of this big WFTDA verse. And I give you, you know, mad props for, you know, just continuing to speak up and be true to who you are and make these things be known and aware. So I think not only that, I mean, your artwork is amazing.
But to that, not just to spotlight Black skaters or people of color, Indigenous skaters, but not to speak up for, but in your own home leagues, when you see things that are not right and things that need to be spoken on in your home leagues, that's where it starts. Say something, be allies, threaten the status quo that makes environments for Black skaters, for people of color, for Indigenous skaters, when our environments are not comfortable or not safe for us, to speak up for that, to say something, to stand beside us, to use your privilege to make and enact change in your home teams, in your home leagues. That's how it starts, and that's how that skating community and park skating as well, not just derby skating. That's how that change that we want to see and the thing that we say about skating community is so welcoming and inviting. It is not for everybody. And in order for it to be that for everybody, we all have to do those hard jobs in our leagues and not just put the onus on the Black skaters, on the people of color, to fight by ourselves to make that change.
Yes, absolutely. We all need to stand together and not be divided, you know. And you mentioned ramp skating. So am I understanding right that you're working on, that's your primary skating that you're doing right now, is you're doing ramp skating and bowl skating?
Yeah, I'm learning and I'm a baby in this all over again, something new, and trying to learn to jam skate at the same time. But for the past two, three years, off and on, I've been playing around in the bowls and on ramps. And I finally put a mini together last year in my backyard that's been sitting in pieces for forever. So yeah, I'm slowly learning it. It's fun and it's scary all at the same time.
What's it like being in that moment again where, you know, like you said, you're kind of like a baby on wheels starting all over again, going from, you know, like fresh meat status or what have you. You know, how does that touch you to get you to want to keep coming back?
Well, it's definitely intimidating. Like there are weeks at a time where I'm just like, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? And I'll like not skate and I'll not touch my ramp. But I'm like, you know what? I love skating. That's what keeps me going into it. Cause I'm like, there's no other sport that I would want to dedicate that much time and skin to. Definitely skin myself and hurt myself and knock things. And I'm just like, I'm stubborn where if I set out to do something and I say I want to not master it, but if I want to get better in it, I'm going to have to do it. Like, I'm just that stubborn. So derby, it took me a while to get better, but I got better.
So is the ramp that you have that you made for your home, we have a video of that as well. Now, is that ramp actually called Pipe Dreams?
It is.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about that process, and what it's really like to have, you know, your own setup to practice really whenever you want, I suppose.
Oh, it's awesome. I mean, it's an old ass ramp. It's like, I think I'm the third person to own this ramp. My friend Sarah got it from someone and she had it in her yard, and Sarah went from not knowing how to skate to she can skate better than me. And like, because she was just dedicated. Sarah skated that ramp every day. She went to the park every day. So she moved, her and her partner moved to California and they got rid of the ramp. So I got the ramp, moved it to my yard, and there it sat for like 2 years. That's at least it felt like 2 years. So after a while, I was just like, forget it. I need to do this ramp. And started to put it together. A big group of my awesome friends came by and helped me move all the pieces together last year to finally like get it together and get it skinned. And it took a while for me to actually get to this point where I'm actually reskinning it. I skinned it once, it rained, and the wood warped, and it was just ruined. It's just ruined. Because I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And I was like, womp womp, money wasted. So I actually like asked around and asked people, hey, if I do wood, went to the hardware store, what can I do to make this last? And they told me how to seal it and everything. So I was like, you know what? I went through a really rough patch at the end of last year, and this was kind of my therapy to help get my mind off of things. So for a solid straight week, I just would go in the garage and paint every morning that I got up. It made me feel better. Art is definitely part of that art therapy. As far as like getting your mind off of things and just redirecting my energy and my thought process. So these are 4x8 sheets. My mini is, I think, 22 feet long by 8 feet wide. And I think it's maybe three feet tall. It's a baby, but it terrified me when my friend Sarah had it, and I would not drop in on it, but now I can drop in on it. I can stall on it. I can do transitions on it because I have it in my backyard to practice whenever I want. So it really meant a lot for me to reskin this and to put my art on it. And to also take the things that Jay taught me from Laced and Found on how to spray. This is my second project after I did the Mabel Davis skate park. So that was really a feat for me to just take what he taught me and see if I could actually do it.
Yeah, I see the letter sequence there, and it was highlighted at the beginning of the video where you could really see how it was overlaid on your product. Now, above what you're painting right now, you've got just a piece of brown paper. Tell me about what's going on up there.
That's just a practice sheet because I'm still learning how to control the can control, basically nozzle control, how to control thick to thin lines, how to control, you know, blending. So before I would spray on my board, I would just practice up top and spray a few times and to clear the nozzle out, make sure there was no clogs in it. But basically just a practice sheet before I actually put it on the board because I'm still scared of laying down paint and messing something up, but you really can't mess it up. You just spray over it.
Right. That makes more sense than what I was thinking. I was like, oh, maybe that's where she puts the colors for the color palette. But hey, you know, you can see that up there too.
Oh yeah, it's definitely up there too. It's like I spray and see what colors. I already had worked out my color palette beforehand when I picked all my colors because it was from a drawing that I had done. And then I was like, you know what? That would be perfect on my ramp. And I posted up on Instagram to ask my friends, hey, what should I name my ramp? And one of my friends was like, I have dreams. And I was like, holy shit, how did I think of that? Because for some of us, it's a pipe dream that won't, you know, you see awesome skaters that are awesome trick skaters and aerial skaters.
Yeah.
And a lot of people think that, you know, because you do ramps and bowls and park that everybody can do that. For some of us, it's a pipe dream. We'll never do that. We'll some of us just will learn a carve, and that's fine because that's all I want to do is learn a carve. I'm not going to be doing backflips. I'm 42. I'm not going to be doing flat backflips into a bowl, cartwheels. Who knows? I may not. And it's also some people's pipe dreams to ascend to the point where they master this and they can, you know, skate a pipe, half pipe, full pipe. So it's a play on words. So it kind of fit perfectly with my ramp.
I really love the double meaning and how it you know, affects you emotionally too, because you know, so much of us put so much blood, sweat, and tears into trying to learn something new on skates, whether it's jam skating, pipe or ramp skating, roller derby, and to be able to take those emotion and put this out on your pipe or your ramp, just to remind you each time you roll back and forth why you're there and what you're doing. I think that's amazing.
Yeah, she's kind of floating in this. She's floating in the clouds. It's very ethereal, and I was like, "Oh, that's going to be on my ramp." So I put her on there, and now every time I go out there, she's out there. She's like, "You can do it."
Just giving you that little bit of extra motivation to keep doing what you got to do. I just think that's just so great. Are there any other large pieces that? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead. No. Go ahead.
No. No, you first. I insist.
No, I was just saying it was really cool to turn my sketch into a big piece and put it on my skate ramp.
Now, we have the mural and we have the big piece on the skate ramp. Is doing oversized projects, is that something that is common for you?
No, it's not. It's the first time I've really stepped out. I've done a couple small walls. I did a couple walls at a Cole space, Collab. It's a neighborhood space that has workshops and teaches like laser cutting and 3D printing. And that's here on the east in East Austin as well. And I painted it. They let me paint a couple of their walls. Awesome group of people that are doing things in the community for the community. I did a skate shop wall for my friend's shop in Houston years ago. But no, it's not really common for me. But I would love to expand and start doing more mural work and more large scale art. It's awesome.
Well, I am blown away by your technique and your ability. I think that you've brought a lot to the show today that people can take back and really apply or think about when they're doing their next projects. I just have one more question about your ramp. So it looks like a lot really went into making your pipe dreams come true. So what pro tips could you give the viewers if they're looking to build their own pipe? Maybe like that one thing where you're like, don't do this.
Well, I got bones from an old ramp, so I really didn't have to do it from scratch. But what I have learned about trying to refurbish this thing so it's skatable, level your ground. Because my ramp is just a little wonky, so you have to accommodate for that when you skate on it. Just a little bit off, just a slight bit, but it's noticeable. I notice it. But pro tip: level before you build your skate ramp. Do not build your skate ramp on off ground.
And the paint that you used for the ramp itself, is that the same outdoor paint you used on the mural?
Yep, it's just outdoor bear. I think it's Bear Ultimate and spray paint and paint pens. And I also sealed it with a deck sealant, a transparent deck sealant. So it's rained on that thing, like torrential rain, a lot, and it has not warped. And I think I finished that, September of last year. It's dirty as hell right now because of the weather and skating on her. I wish it still looked that clean and pristine, but all my skate marks are on there. But sealing it definitely is making it last longer. I know eventually the wood is going to break down and warp because it's not skate light or gator skins, which is made for outside and indoor and outdoor ramps. But for what I paid for the wood and being able to have it this long, yeah, I'm fine with it.
Well, I'm curious what a picture looks like now. So you'll have to share that with us at some point on one of your social medias. Show us how she's holding up.
We have a couple tomorrow.
Perfect. We have a couple of questions in the chat, actually. Slamwise Gamgee 25, she wants to know if you ever sell prints.
I do, actually. I've been doing that for the past 5 years is mixed Hues. You can always message me online. My website takes forever and I've been updating it forever. And it seems like it's been the slowest process possible because I'm not a web designer. I'm a different kind of artist, but you can always contact me and shortly you can get them again on my website, but I definitely sell prints.
We also have a question from Cakes. She says, if someone wanted to commission you for mural art, how would they get a hold of you? Would you prefer through the website or email?
Website. My email is on my website. I prefer through my website or through my email address, but you can find me on Instagram as well. A lot of people contact me on Instagram for that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at this picture here, and going through your sites, you've so much to offer and such a variety, and it's all unique. It's not, I wouldn't say that it's cookie cutter stuff. You know, you pour your personality into each piece, and you have a bunch of different mediums to choose from, which keeps it fresh and exciting. And I look forward to following along and seeing where your artistic journey continues to take you. I mean, you have a 3D video on your site that you made for carotid arteries. I was like, she made this too? Like, what? The sky's the limit for you. There's no bounds.
I do a lot of different forms of art, a lot.
So folks, I think the rule of thumb is no matter what you're looking for, reach out to her. If she can't get you taken care of, I'm sure she knows somebody who could. And it sounds like she's going to be the one to do it. just double checking one last time. Let's see. Looks like they're sharing your contact information and social media in the Twitch chat bar. So unfortunately, it looks like all good things, this too must come to an end. Can you leave us with some parting words, where we can find you? I know we talked about that a little bit, but and if you have anything coming up that we should be looking out for?
You can find me always on Instagram at Mixed Hues, mixedhues.com for my website. Coming up. Keep an eye out for something coming up with About Betty's. I can't say what it is, but just keep an eye out for that. They will drop that soon. Parting words. Stay safe. Wash your hands and be kind to people.
That's the trifecta right there. Stay safe, wash your hands, and be kind. I couldn't have said it better myself. Sam, thank you so much for joining me today and talking with me about your wonderful roller derby journey and how it's brought into your artistic life. And thank you for sharing your art with us. Make sure you check her out on mixedhues.com, Facebook, and Instagram. Sam, until we talk next time. Have a good night.
Thank you. Thank you. You too.
So much talent packed into one person. Again, make sure you check her out on Instagram, Facebook, mixedhues.com. We'll list all of her contact information below. Viewers, click the heart in the upper right corner on Twitch to be notified when we go live for future episodes. If you're watching this on YouTube, hit that like button and subscribe to the channel to see all your favorite WFTDA.TV shows. Don't be shy. Leave a comment in YouTube to tell us who you'd like to see featured on the next Collab Lab. Thank you for joining me today. I look forward to chatting with you all each night or each Wednesday right here on WFTDA.TV. I've been your host, Aurelia. Until next time, take care.